Right here, I've got a 100 hertz sine wave shown on a spectrogram. Right now, it's just a line of color at 100 hertz, but watch what happens when I turn on the SoundToys decapitator plugin. Now we see a few additional frequencies higher up in the frequency spectrum, even though the input signal is still just a pure sine wave. And when we turn up the drive knob, we see that not only do more frequencies start to pop up, but also that the balance of those frequencies start to change depending on how the drive knob is set. When you look closer, you see that these aren't just random frequencies either. They follow a harmonic pattern. The first harmonic is our fundamental at 100 hertz, the second harmonic at 200 hertz, third harmonic at 300 hertz, fourth harmonic at 400 hertz, and so on. And look at the oscilloscope that shows the shape of the wave. As we increase the drive knob, we increase the amount of saturation that occurs, and the shape of the wave changes or becomes distorted. This is the first thing to understand when learning about saturation. The shape of the waveform on an oscilloscope and the balance of the harmonic frequencies on a frequency analyzer graph are one and the same. Two ways of understanding the same thing. Let me explain what I mean. Remember the harmonic pattern we saw? 100 hertz, 200 hertz, 300 hertz, and so on. The second, fourth, sixth, and other even order harmonics are even multiples of the fundamental frequency. In this case, that's 200 hertz, 400 hertz, 600 hertz, etc. The third, fifth, seventh, and other odd order harmonics are odd multiples of the fundamental frequency. 300 hertz, 500 hertz, 700 hertz, etc. It's often said that even order harmonics are generally more pleasing than odd order harmonics. And while there is some truth to that, they all have a place in music, as you'll see in the practical demonstrations later in the video. But before we get there, I want to show you a few types of waveforms that highlight the relationship between wave shape and harmonic content. Let's start with a triangle wave. A triangle wave consists of only odd order harmonics. In this case, we see a triangle wave with a fundamental frequency of 1 hertz on the graph. And on the frequency graph, we see that this wave also contains odd order harmonics, like 3 hertz, 5 hertz, 7 hertz, 9 hertz, and so on. And the relative level of each harmonic frequency decreases the further you go from the fundamental frequency. The second wave I want to show you is a square wave. Notice that the frequencies in a square wave are exactly the same as the triangle wave, but this time they taper at a less drastic rate. The same frequencies with a different relative balance will result in a much different sound, as you can hear. Finally, when we look at a sawtooth wave, we see that it consists of odd and even order harmonics. The waveform resembles the linear rise of the triangle wave with the instantaneous drop of the square wave. And again, the resulting sound is easily distinguishable from the others. Now you might be asking yourself, why does changing the shape of a wave result in additional frequencies? And this is where it gets very interesting. Every complex waveform can be built by simply layering higher frequency sine waves together. If you were to put the fundamental frequency 1 hertz and its third harmonic 3 hertz on a graph, it would look like this. But if you've ever zoomed in on a DAW to see what all of the frequencies in your music look like, you wouldn't see a bunch of separate sine waves like this. You'd see one very complex wave that represents the combined amplitude and frequency of every instrument in the mix. When we converge 1 hertz and 3 hertz, it creates a wave that is slightly flattened on the top. Add another odd order harmonic, and the waveform flattens out even more. And when we keep adding more and more odd order harmonics, they eventually sum together to create something that looks a lot like a square wave. Remember, the lower frequencies have much greater amplitude compared to the higher frequencies. So the resulting sum of all of these frequencies resembles the fundamental sine wave with very quick transitions from positive to negative and from negative to positive. To bring this back to the idea of mixing with saturation, think about what happens when you slowly increase the signal level in a completely linear system. The amplitude grows larger, but the shape of the wave is otherwise unchanged. Of course, Completely linear audio systems don't exist in the real world. A digital system can be totally linear up until a certain point, but when you exceed 0 dB full scale in a fixed point digital system, you immediately see a lot of distortion in the form of clipping. The top of the waveform is chopped off, resulting in a shape that can be understood as the sum of many higher frequency sine waves. In the analog realm, we start to see non-linearities even before exceeding the intended limit of the circuit. That's because the shape of the waveform is somewhat changed or distorted even within the intended operating levels. This causes problems in some cases, but it brings richness, vibe, and warmth in other cases. And it's one of the biggest factors that make analog hardware so sought after, and it's the reason why these style options in the Soundtoys Decapitator plugin were modeled after classic analog gear. The A style was modeled after the Ampex 350 tape drive preamp. The E style was modeled after the Chandler EMI TG channel. The N style was modeled after the Neve 1057 input channel. The T style was modeled after the Culture Vulture triode setting, and the P style was modeled after the Culture Vulture pentode setting. Notice that the balance of odd and even harmonics that arise with each of these styles are unique, and also notice that adjusting the drive setting in any one of these styles results in a unique nonlinear outcome. I get a lot of comments saying that gain staging is obsolete, but here's one of many instances where that is incorrect. Because not only do the style and drive settings impact the behavior of this plugin, but so does the input, meaning that the behavior will be different based on the amplitude and frequency content of the input signal. And right here, we've got the Soundtoys radiator with its own unique sound. Just running a signal through this plugin and the Altec mixer after which it's modeled can have an effect. Listen to the before and after on drums. These nonlinear plugins are designed to bring some life back into the digital realm. Because even though digital has a lot of benefits, it sometimes lacks that analog flavor that's been sprinkled into records over the last century. Now, I want to share with you a few of the many ways you can mix with saturation. Use the link below to download the free trial of the plugins and apply these techniques in your own music. First off, let me mention that the examples are going to be pretty obvious in some cases, in order to convey the impacts of saturation in an educational way that everybody can hear. There are ways to use saturation in very obvious ways and extremely subtle ways, so I encourage you to try it for yourself in your own mixing environment.